us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Let's sing that again. Show us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to North Burlington Baptist Church. And a special welcome if you are new or visiting us with us here this morning, or if you are joining us on Coachego. I had an interesting conversation with some colleagues this week at work. We're sitting in the lunchroom, and one of my colleagues is preparing for a wedding she's attending this summer. And thinking ahead, she's trying to find a babysitter. So she's asking around the room, how do you find a babysitter? And the consensus generally was, well, you get a referral from a trusted friend, or you post an advertisement, or accept an advertisement. That's how you find a babysitter. And she looked at me and she said, Caitlin, well, how did you find your babysitters? And I said, well, we've had a few and loved them, and there's probably four or five people I could think of that we've met at our church that I'm more than comfortable with leaving Benjamin with. And she said, jokingly, but said, oh, you know what? I should join a church so that I can find a babysitter and get to know people in my neighborhood who are of babysitting age. And her point struck me because, first, it made me very appreciative that we do know so many people that I'd be happy to leave Benjamin with. But more so, how do you meet people in your neighborhood of different ages? For her, she's looking for a babysitter, but how else do we meet people of different backgrounds? And I think that society, whether they realize it consciously or not, I think it's missing that piece, that sense of community, that difference that we bring together here as a congregation. And I think it's something we should be very proud of and something that we should celebrate and bring out to our neighborhoods. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that we can come here and worship you. And we thank you that although we are very different, we are different ages, different phases in life, very different interests, talents, and gifts. But God, with you as our Father, and with Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have a lot in common. And we thank you for that. We pray that people in our communities and in our neighborhoods will see that, will see your grace and mercy, will want that, will seek you out, and will deepen their relationship with you as their personal Lord and Savior. We pray that you will bless this service as Merv conquers yet another very difficult conversation and topic. We pray that you will give him the words And that, God, that you will open our hearts and let us hear your word, not what society is telling us or our preconceived notions, but that we will be open to hearing your words. In your son's precious name we pray. Amen. If you look at your bulletin, there are a few announcements. Most of them are listed in there, but I would like to highlight a couple that are not listed in your bulletin. First, if you can mark, at least in your head for now, February 21st, it's our next annual meeting. So our annual meeting is February 21st. It's not in your bulletin. The other thing not in your bulletin is Sunday, February 26th, we are going to be having a baptism. So, if you are interested in being baptized, if you're interested in knowing just more about what that is and what that looks like, please speak to either Merv or Wayne, and they'd be happy to answer your questions. So Sunday, February 26th is our next baptism. Finally, it is in your bulletin on February the 18th. The Toronto Children's Choir is doing a concert fundraiser for CBM, and it's taking place right here at NBBC at 7 o'clock. Tickets and all information are listed in the bulletin, so check that out. We'll now turn things over to the praise team.
So how is everyone today? You're doing great. I'm always excited when we get together and we can lift up the name of Jesus together, and to learn more and to encourage one another. We do have a lot to celebrate, as Caitlin said. Amen?
Amen.
I want you to say in maybe one word or three or four words, what are you celebrating today? Could be an event or something that's gone on. What are you celebrating?
Super Bowl.
Super Bowl. How did I know that was going to come up? What else are we celebrating?
My mom's birthday.
Awesome.
Oh, nice.
What else are you celebrating?
Happy birthday.
You're all dismissed.
There's always one.
Oh, okay, yes. Nancy and her snow angels. That's right. What else are the rest of you celebrating?
Semester two starts.
Semester two starts. All right. Amen. What else? Because you lost your voice, or? Oh, you're choked up. Is it about your son? Did he have a surgery yesterday? How'd it go? So Beryl's son, Peter, had some surgery yesterday. There was some aneurysm happening, and had some immediate surgery. We've been praying for Peter, and glad to hear it went well yesterday. Awesome. What else are we celebrating? What's coming up? Valentine's. Yeah, all the guys are for sure. No, I mean we are. But. All right. Why don't you stand with me? We're going to sing a few songs. I think a lot of you could have said a lot more about what we're celebrating. I hope you could. When Jesus Christ is in your vision, there is a lot to celebrate. Let me say that again. When Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, your Creator, the beloved Son of the Father, when this person, this man, this God, is in your vision, there's a lot to celebrate. Let me say it one more time.
Hallelujah.
When Jesus Christ, the one who came to the earth to be obedient to the Father, to do the will of the Father, when he is in your vision, you have a lot to celebrate. Amen?
Hallelujah.
I hope he's in your vision today. And if he's not, if he's kind of in the side, blind sides, I pray that you would just turn to him today and see his face. That you would return to a loving Father who is full of grace and forgiveness. When he is in your vision, you have a lot to celebrate.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else. waking or sleeping, thy presence my
some of you dancing.
We're choosing celebration, breaking into freedom. You're the song, you're the song of our hearts. We cast aside our shadows, trust you with our sorrows. You're the song of our hearts. We're dancing to the rhythm of your heart. We're rising from the ashes to the stars.
Here we go, you're the joy.
You're the joy, joy, joy.
Joy, 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 lighting my soul.
the joy, joy, joy.
At this time, the ushers will come take up our worship through offering. We talked a little bit about vision, having Jesus in our sight. Now, how is that possible when he's gone to be with the Father? I mean, the disciples, the apostles, the people of his time were able to see him. How easy it must have been to demonstrate faith when you could see Jesus do the miracles. How is it possible for us to have Jesus as that vision? Jesus Christ himself said, those that believe, although they have not seen, have greater faith. So it's about faith in his word and in the man of Jesus. And this song talks about that, him being Hosanna. I see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Let me hear you sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna.
So if you see me grimacing a little bit today, a little bit sore, I hurt my back. I know. And a lesser human would be laid up. But, you know, I'm no mere mortal. Let me just put it that way. And so I am here because I serve you. And no tragedy could keep me from being before you today. Rob wanted me to remind you there's a football game this afternoon. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's called the Super Bowl, and there is a cultural relevance to this game where people gather not to watch the game but to eat large quantities of food. Okay, that's what I do. Anyways, And my wife has generously made her maple baked beans, which they might even make it to the game this year, who knows. But if they don't, you'll hear about them later. Anyway, so Rob's place, kickoff's at 6:30. You can start arriving at 6. And also, I wanted to say a word about baptisms. Sometimes I talk to people and they profess, I follow Jesus, but they've never actually identified publicly with him. And so I just want to encourage you, if it's your stance that you say, yeah, I'm a follower of Jesus, and you want to follow him, his example was to get baptized because he said it was right to do it. So if you have not yet done that and you've never been challenged, consider this a challenge. And I invite you to consider getting baptized coming up. And you can talk to me or use a communication card. I'd be happy to talk to you about that. You know, sometimes when I drive my car, I hear this squeaking sound. And my general response is determined that there is this annoying sound. And I find that if I turn up the radio, the squeaking sound is taken care of. This is me. That's how but not my wife. My wife, when she hears a squeaking sound, her general response is determined that there's something wrong with the car. And then she takes it to the mechanic, or more properly, she gets me to take it to the mechanic, and the squeaking sound is then taken care of. But then my mechanic will take the car for a test drive, and when he hears the squeaking sound, he's able to isolate its location and determine if the type of squeak, you know, is it a worn brake pad or a bent brake rotator shield, or is it a wheel bearing failure or a loose serpentine belt? And these are the kinds of things he's thinking when he hears a squeaking sound. And then once he determines the source of the squeak, he replaces the part that he's replacing, and the squeaking sound is taken care of. Each of us hear, interpret, and deal with the sound. Some do it in more appropriate ways than others. And arguably, the mechanic is the most effective at hearing and dealing most appropriately with the sound. But this skill was not automatic. It came through a combination of training and experience. This is the way that all skills are developed and improved. Over the last few weeks, we've been exploring how we can improve our skills of theological reflection. How can we think in ways which reflect the character of God and the truth of his word? And the truth is that we engage in theological reflection as we seek to live our lives to follow the example of Jesus all the time. People do this all the time. Actually, I remember, Janet, when you spoke on this, and an illustration she used was when her child got sick, and she came to her and said, does this mean that God doesn't love me? That's theological reflection, and we do that all the time. And so we've been doing this series called Oh Canada, depending on, and we've sought to take culturally relevant topics and tried to think theologically well about them. So the real sermon is about theological reflection, but the way we're getting at it is by looking at some topics that we're facing as Canadians. So in week one, we looked at the topic of assisted suicide and euthanasia. In week two, we looked at the topic of recreational marijuana. In week three, we looked at technology. And today, which is the last Sunday in this series, and by the way, I've gotten a good response. I think people have enjoyed this series. More for you hearing and then for me who had to deliver, by the way. This is a lot of work and intimidating. But I'd like to kind of explore this thing of looking at cultural issues again. So if you have a topic that you would like to look at, use a communication card, let me know, and then I'll determine if I'm bold enough to take it on. But this is the last Sunday in the series, but we might do another one later. And today we're going to consider the topic of transgenderism. And I suppose that one of the first time I was confronted by the whole idea of transgenderism was when I finally paid attention to the lyrics of a song from the 1970s, actually 1970s year it came out, by the Kinks called Lola. I met her in a club down in Old Soho where you drink champagne and it tastes just like Coca-Cola, C-O-L-A, Cola, you know something? She walked up to me and she asked me to dance. I asked her name in a dark brown voice. She said, Lola. L-O-L-A, Lola. Well, I'm not the world's most physical guy, but when she squeezed me tight, she nearly broke my spine. Oh, my Lola. Well, I'm not dumb, but I can't understand why she walks like a woman and talks like a man. Oh, my Lola. And the song goes on at the end line, says, girls will be boys, and boys will be girls. It's a mixed up, muddle up, shook up world. Do you remember that song? You guys are old. There used to be a time when the world was divided by simply two genders, and for the majority of people, these two classifications fit well. And for the majority of people, they still do. Gender identity is simply how people experience themselves as male or female, including how masculine or how feminine they feel. And there are some people who do not feel at home in the gender that their body has been assigned. Traditionally, it's called gender dysphoria. Dysphoria means a state of feeling unwell or unhappy. Think of it as the opposite of euphoria. Okay? And gender dysphoria issues are not about having sex or attraction to the same sex. They're about an experiential mismatch between one's psychology and one's biology. Psychologists do not know what causes gender dysphoria. The most popular theory at this point suggests that as people are developing, the brain maps either towards male or female, which normally corresponds with the person's biology. In rare instances, the brain maps in a direction other than the person's biology. Accurate numbers for transgender persons are difficult to obtain. One statistic said that the percentage of transgender males was as low as 0.005 to 0.014% of the population, and for women, it was 0.002 to 0.003% of the total population. However, according to another report, the number of transgender people has doubled in the last decade, no doubt because of the growing social acceptance that people now feel in coming out. The degree to which people experience their dysphoria also varies. One scale has six levels of gender identity disorder. So the occasional cross-dresser is level one, and then a person who has had hormone replacement and surgical procedures such as a vaginectomy or a penectomy has completed the final steps. To be honest, this is not an easy issue to navigate. It's complex on lots of levels. And so, as we ought always to do when information that we have is scant, when we really could use more light in a situation, I think we're wise to hold our positions with humility and a ready acknowledgement that we might be wrong. As I think through the issues and listen to the discussions, I think there's some confusion and tension that arise that has to do with different points of reference in the conversation. There are the feelings of gender dysphoria, the psychological realities, but there's also the responding actions of people as they choose how to act now with regard to those feelings. And I believe that it's easy to ask the question, what does God think about this issue without differentiating between, are we talking about how they're feeling or how they're behaving? And we also sometimes talk about people as if, there's people who are following Jesus and are committed to that, and those who simply are not committed to it. And sometimes the Christian community can be guilty of trying to impose a morality upon people who have not signed up to follow Jesus, who have not said, I want to do what the Bible says, and they have not even received the Spirit of God to help them in order to do that. So broadly speaking, there are these three main categories, but I want you to look at this chart just for a second. So when we're talking about gender dysphoria, I think we have to be clear, are we talking about a follower of Jesus and how they feel, or a follower of Jesus and how they act on those feelings, or a non-follower and how they feel and how they act? And sometimes we blur it all together and think everybody ought to be the same, and I think there's differences within that chart. So broadly speaking, there's three main positions that sincere Christians wrestle to reconcile Scripture with what people experience and what they hold. Some think the issue is not that complex at all. After all, Genesis narrates the creation of humanity, and in Genesis 1, we read, "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over the creatures that move along the ground.' So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them." And then in a fuller description of God's special creation of humanity, Genesis tells, it tells the same story, but in this way, an expanded version. "But for God, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, 'This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man.' That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh." Now, some argue that God created male and female, and that one's sex and one's gender are the same. They're gifts from God. They simply need to be embraced. And for some, they argue that failure to embrace one's assigned gender at birth is simply just sinful. Now, the challenge to this position is that it seems clear that gender dysphoria is a mental health issue that is a diagnosed condition. So that if that's the case, should it be approached like a predisposition to behavior which calls for moral evaluation as we might evaluate some sexual behavior? Dr. Mark Yarhaus, a Christian clinical psychologist and director of the Institute for the Study of Sexual Identity, comments in this way: "Do we view a person's depression as sin? Or a person's struggle with schizophrenia as sin? The person may have choices to make that are associated with their response to symptoms or overall treatment approach. And those choices may have moral and ethical dimensions, but their condition is not one that they chose. That is, they are not morally culpable for having it." And so a second position would agree that Genesis tells us how God intended things to be. The problem is that in the very next chapter in Genesis, it explains that sin entered the world and everything got messed up. Like, everything. Nothing was not touched. Or everything was touched. And so we find that physically, sometimes people are born with sexual organs that are ambiguous. There are some who are born with both sex organs. There's one condition I read where, due to an enzyme deficiency, a person is born with female genitalia, and then with a surge of testosterone at puberty, develop genitals and mature into men. And it is not only physically that one's gender can be distorted. Psychologically, there are those whose brains are telling them they are not the sex they have been born with. Sometimes the human condition is not the way it's supposed to be. At one time, in discussing marriage, Jesus made this comment. Jesus replied, not everyone can accept this word, but only those to whom it has been given. For there are eunuchs who have been born that way, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by others, and there are those who choose to live like eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. The one who can accept this should accept it. Jesus identifies three types of eunuchs: those who are made that way, often castrated by others, and often this was done by kings to keep men from being sexually tempted as they served the king and took care of his harem. Some choose to live like eunuchs, choosing to deny their sexual appetite for the sake of focusing upon the kingdom of heaven. And there are some who are born this way, said Jesus. And the text leaves as ambiguous if this is because they are born this way physically or if they are born this way psychologically. So in this second position, people would argue that someone born with gender dysphoria should be treated without prejudice and with compassion, since they bear a difficult lot in life. A third position would argue that suggesting that transgenderism is in some ways a dis- disability is equivalent to shaming that person. They would argue that this is simply a third way of being, one that all cultures across time have acknowledged, and that they should be then celebrated. To suggest that there are only two ways that gender identity can be expressed, they would argue, is morally wrong. And some theologians point to the initial creation of humanity, and they say that God began by creating an androgynous being who has neither male nor female gender, that he caused to go to sleep, and from which he divides the human by taking a rib and forming it into a woman. This, they would say, suggests that gender identity is then therefore fluid, and all people fit on a spectrum between male and female, and all points along that spectrum should be equally celebrated and embraced. In his book, Understanding Gender Dysphoria, Dr. Yarhouse tells of his many conversations with Christians who struggle with gender dysphoria and how they've been treated by the church. He writes this: what most people who are gender dysphoric find in the church is rejection and shame. The feeling that there is something fundamentally flawed with them, and that flaw is their fault, a willful disobedience, and that if others knew about their gender incongruence, they too would reject them. When asked what kind of support would you like to have from the church, one transgender Christian shared, "Someone to cry with me rather than just denounce me. Hey, it's scary to see God not rescue someone from cancer or schizophrenia or gender dysphoria, but learn how to allow your compassion to overcome your fear and repulsion." I think that part of the challenge as we struggle with how to think theologically well with regard to gender dysphoria and transgender identity is our own discomfort. And rather than project upon you feelings that may not be true, let me say it of myself, it's my discomfort. With all the subjectivity and ambivalence of it all, I know I find myself asking how a person knows that the feeling they have on the inside is the feeling of being a different sex. To what do they compare it to confirm? How do you know that what you're feeling is the gender of another and not how that gender normally feels? I feel uncomfortable with the lack of scientific verification. And when you consider how easily self-deceived we can become as people, how incredibly mixed our motives can be, and how our freedom can be so easily abused, and the risk of long-term psychological damage that is potentially possible, when I consider this, I question if the most loving response is unquestioned acceptance and celebration. Furthermore, we need to acknowledge that there are some who try and leverage the dysphoria of a minority in order to drive an agenda which tries to deconstruct sex and gender and so undermine the beauty of gender distinctives within people. There's some people who are just driving an agenda and using this and those people as a tool. And in particular, I am concerned at the rate of adoption that Canada in particular has embraced what I would consider radical gender therapies, especially in young children and pre-adolescents who are still naive about so much regarding sexuality and gender. In a Globe and Mail article from January of this year, the writer makes this comment: "The activists believe that children's expressions of gender identity should automatically be taken at face value. Simply put, the child knows best. This is how the mainstream view, celebrated in the media, endorsed by progressive politicians, vigorously embraced by our school systems, and robustly promoted by a growing number of medical practitioners who do not hesitate to prescribe powerful, life-altering drugs to adolescents and teenagers. Countless parents who would never feed their kid a peanut have now been persuaded to make a drastic social and biomedical decisions that will irrevocably alter their child's life." In a BBC documentary, Dr. Zucker, one of the world's leading experts on child and adolescent dysphoria, makes this comment: "There is not one cause for gender dysphoria. Children don't always know what's best for them, and neither do we. It takes a long time for a child to know who he really is." Astonishingly, this common sense position is considered unacceptable, even abusive. Ray Blanchard, an expert in transsexualism at the University of Toronto, says many professionals agree in private with Dr. Zucker, but they'd be terrified to say it in public. And what's shocking about this push to transition kids is that most of the time, the kids grow out of it. By adolescence, the majority, studies average around 80%, according to the documentary, reconcile with their birth gender. Australian pediatrics professor John Whitehall made this comment regarding Canada's eagerness to push transitioning children. What astonishes me is the lack of evidence to support massive medical intervention aimed at a child's sex, changing a child's sex, when such procedures are simply not necessary. So where does this leave us? I think we're naive to believe that those who genuinely struggle with gender dysphoria are simply rebellious and sinful. I can only imagine how scary and alienating it must feel to not feel at home in your own body. I think that there needs to be a community which supports people who are struggling to feel safe so that they can take their time to wrestle with their feelings, as we would with any mental health issue. But there is one last point I'd like to make. In Galatians 3, Paul is writing to the church regarding the change that's taken place in each person when they put their faith in Jesus. And he writes this: "For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." Paul is addressing the issue of core identity. And whereas prior to being clothed in Christ, Paul writes, we tried to hang our core identities around issues of ethnicity, whether I was a Jew or a Gentile, or issues of status, whether I was a slave or a freeman, or around our gender, whether as male nor a female. But Paul makes the point that our core identity is no longer primarily any of these things, but rather it is our status of being in Christ. It is our relationship with Christ that now forms the very center of who we are. Nothing else is strong enough to pull the fragmented pieces of our identity into a coherent whole so that we flourish as human beings. In other words, we were made to be in Christ from the very beginning, and apart from him, we are all in a state of dysphoria. And I think that for those who are striving to follow the way of Jesus, who struggle with gender dysphoria, it would be wise to not put a weight of their core identity upon their gender, which can only be sufficiently borne by Christ. And this, I think, is a challenge to all Christians to increasingly embrace their core identity as part of the new humanity centered in Jesus. And for such a task, we all need a community where we can encourage and challenge and support one another. To be honest, I wish the answers were cleaner and simpler. But this is the world we now live in. Thankfully, God has promised to be with us and guide us, even if the way forward is shrouded and dimly lit. Are there any questions? And I'd say, Migas, we have communion. I don't want to make it a long service, but I know there's probably some questions. So are there any questions we can talk about? Obviously, 25 minutes is not enough to discuss a topic like this. Any questions? Yes.
For the issue of the issue raised today has historically been looked at differently. Some ancient cultures revered people who had gender dysphoria, but a majority of those societies through history also believed in reincarnation, the principle being that as you go through life and successive sojourns onto the earth, you can have different gender. You can be a woman in one lifetime if you believe in that theory. What's your view in that? Because you didn't bring any of that up, that we're, as souls, we're all journeying back to Christ.
Yeah.
And for some cultures, they firmly believe that you do.
So the reincarnation theory, would not be historically a Christian theory. The Bible is pretty clear that it's appointed, one of the verses says, it's appointed once for man to die, and then comes the judgment. And so the idea that you come back and are reincarnated as a different being, be an animal or different sexual identity, would not be something that the Bible would teach or support. I don't know, was there another part of the question I'm missing?
No.
Okay. Yeah, so I don't think we find that in Scripture. So if we're seeking, so the issue we're looking at is how do we as Christians think theologically well about the issues? And so our theology obviously is formed by Christian doctrine. So the idea of incarnation is not something Christians generally hold to. Any other questions? Yes.
Just a bit of a comment. I know that the school system has expanded beyond just one. If new
yes. Yeah. Fluid. Yeah.
Genders to be considered for each child to make it their identity. And the other thing that I'm just trying to struggle with in my own brain is any time that we struggle with any sort of sin, how far can that struggle go before it becomes that mental health part and all of a sudden that blame or pinpointing of the problem becomes, well, now it's a mental health thing and it's not just because of the sin you struggle. It sounds a lot like a chicken or the egg kind of thing. Do you become depressed because you've struggled with the same sin for years and haven't found that fix? Or was that struggle or that depression part always there and that is why you did that sin? Because I'm unhappy, but I'm unhappy.
Yeah, yeah, and so when there are mental health issues, we do form habits that can reinforce the mental health illness. But I think there are precedents where we see very early on in people mental health issues that had not yet been formed around habits. Children whose identities from very early on seem to be leaning in ways that are different from others and that kind of thing. And then later it becomes reinforced by habits. So I think there are issues where mental health issues are predeterminative. Yeah.
So in the sense of the scientific understanding of it, should we as Christians get more involved in that? And the reason I bring that up is oftentimes I've been in conversations with people that are very pro this type of ideology. And I find that as Christians sometimes there's not a lot of information from scientific facts that we can bring up. And that's kind of what I sometimes struggle with, is in thinking, should we be more maybe immersed in that, learning more about. Because science has brought a lot of good, but there's also lots of biases in scientists and the scientific community.
Even scientists have agenda, you're right. And this is part of my own discomfort because of the lack of scientific verification that can show that a person has a gender dysphoria. And what complicates it for me is this whole politicizing of the realities. So I think there is a small number of people who genuinely have the psychological dysphoria going on. They don't feel at home in their own bodies. They don't know what to do, and they're looking for help. And then you have a whole group of people who are saying it doesn't matter. Everybody can choose whatever identity they want. And there's people who really aren't psychologically there but decide, I'm going to experiment. And who are you to tell me I can't? And so if you remember that block, there's people who are simply, so let's suggest that they're non-Christians, who are, it's not about the how they think and how they feel, it's just how they're going to decide to behave. And there's certain behaviors that are sinful, right? But we can't impose upon a society, this is what's morally right for you, if you have not chosen to follow Jesus, because the reality is they don't have the Spirit of God to restrain them or help them. But we can always come to the table and say, hey, this is what I feel is good for society, because the way of the Bible teaches how is best for the prosperity of humanity. And so I think we need, I always think we need to be present, giving the rationale for our reasons, while not feeling that we have to impose upon people, because they're just, they're blinded, the scripture says, until Christ comes to meet with them. And what we can show them, hopefully, is something reasonable that they can consider in the process of exploring. They may meet this fellow named Jesus who can open their eyes. So should we be present? Yes. Should we impose? No. Should be accepting? Yes. But should we recognize that there's people who are driving in a political agenda that that is, I think, harmful for society? Yes. We need to be as wise as serpents and as gentle as doves in this. Yes, ma'am.
Just tell this little story. When we were in a church in Oakland, the pastor said that when he was young, just starting out, he was a pastor in a downtown Toronto church. And downtown you get all kinds of, this is quite far, probably in the 70s or 80s. And this man came in to the church and always sat at the back, and he was dressed as a woman. And so he just kind of quietly sat there. It was really awkward, but people in the church would say hi and welcome him and everything, and so he kept coming back and attending. And over time, he actually approached some of the men and said, you know, I'm really confused. I've been kind of living like this, and I can somebody help me learn how to behave like a man? So I think he just was, like you're explaining, mixed up, didn't know. And as he kept hearing the word and he started to hear about Christ, so eventually they met with him, they accepted him, they didn't judge him. And in the end, he became more masculine.
In his behaviors.
Yes. Yeah. And he said, the whole reason I did was because you accepted me, not because you judged me when I came in here.
Yeah, yeah. I'm going to close in prayer, and then we're going to have communion. Father, what we long to be is faithful. What we find hard is when we face issues that really Scripture doesn't say a whole lot, and what we find is people interpret it different ways, and we struggle to know what faithfulness looks like when it's so complex. So, Lord, help us to be able to do those things which we know to do, to love people, to encourage them to know you, and we believe that you can sort everything out. We believe there will come a day when you will come and the earth will be put back to right, and all things will be restored as you originally intended. But until that day, Lord, we know that people wrestle with sin and with dysfunctions. We're all broken and fragmented. Help us as we try to orient our lives around this new creation we have come into, because you have made us into a new humanity. We've been born again. And help us as we seek to center our lives in you and to encourage others to the same. We ask this in your name. Amen. I don't know if you've ever had the experience that I had. This is a few weeks back, but I had this dream about my wife. I can't even remember what it was. I don't know if you remember, honey. But I had this dream about my wife, and she was doing something in the dream to annoy me, like something, I'm pretty sure it was evil. And I remember all night kind of fighting with, I felt all night, it's probably like, you know, not long because you don't dream that long, but I was having this fight with my wife because she was being so bad. And then I woke up. Guess what my mood towards my wife was? Right? Even though I knew it was a dream, I had to really fight to like that woman. It just seems that, you know, the way that your mind goes, it affects your how you behave, how you think, how you react to people, you know. And I'll tell you something, everybody here thinks some things that are just weird. How do I know that? Because I know you. Here's one of the weird things I think when I'm driving. Not all the time, but sometimes. And I see a guy coming up on my tail, I think that guy's a jerk. That guy's like that because he's got issues, right? So what do? I do what any self-respecting person in my position would do. I slow down so I'm parallel with the car beside me, just so that guy can learn not to mess with me. How you think will affect your behaviors, and nobody thinks perfectly well all the time. And eventually I realized, you know, this is probably not how Jesus would think towards that person. What if his wife is in the hospital, he's rushing to get there? I don't know. I mean, he could be thinking stuff about me too, but I don't have to judge him for that. But right now, I have to be responsible for my thoughts. And nobody's thoughts are perfectly oriented in ways that suggest that Christ has control of every aspect of your life. Nobody's. We long for that. We're all struggling to become those kind of people. And some people struggle with things that other people don't struggle with. Some of you have never had road rage in your life. You listen to my story and you think, what's the matter with him, right? And for some people, we look at other people's stories because their experience of what's going on in their head is so different from what we think. We think, what's wrong with them? And we judge them when what they need is love and compassion because they have to work it through. They have to find themselves centered around Christ too. So the question then we end up with is, what kind of people do we want to be in response to other people who are struggling? Whether it be people who struggle with road rage or depression or overeating or even gender dysphoria. What kind of church will we be? Are we going to be the kind of church that judges people? Or are we going to be the type of church that accepts people and then challenges and encourages and supports them to integrate their life around Jesus? I know what kind of church I want us to be. Go now in the grace and in the peace of God as we seek to live out a life that accepts and challenges, that embraces, encourages people to move forward towards Jesus.